All right, Robert Byrd with those referees' instructions to the two fighters. You saw when they were standing up a vast disparity in height. I mean, that is a severe height disadvantage that Fernando Montiel, who may have seen just about all in his long career, has to go up against perhaps the largest situation in terms of physical disadvantage that he's faced in the ring before.
So a younger guy, a taller guy, that's in Selby's advantage. Veterans experience for Montiel, home crowd. And here we are. Will height make right? We'll soon see.
You know, in Montiel's most disastrous night of his career, when he was KO'd in two rounds by Nonito Donaire, it was just felt that Nonito was not only greatly talented, but was too big and too strong for Montiel. Will that be the case here again tonight?
When you get to his spot in life, in your career, you don't always get to choose your situations. Okay, listen, you want the 126-pound belt? All right, you have to take the guy that just won it. Bigger than you, younger, so find a way. That's his dilemma. Selby just missing with the right hand, and you can see how he keeps that jab out. Way to maximize his reach.
Selby is an interesting guy because he uses all 20 feet of the ring, Dave. He moves, he jabs very well, but he has the ability to still be an exciting fighter. Just because you're a boxer and a mover doesn't mean you're not exciting. And Selby has proven in a lot of his fights that he can be an exciting fighter.
And he'll have to be at the juncture now of moving up the ladder. 8 knockouts in 22 fights, so he's not stamped as a puncher. But he'll have to get his audience with nonstop action, being a very busy fighter and being on top of his opponent.
Montiel, on the other hand, is already trying to see how he can figure out a way to get away from Selby's reach. One thing I don't like so far is he's been kind of leaning back. And if he gets caught on a lot of the tail end of those jabs, can't find a way inside, it's gonna be, could be a tough night for Montiel.
Montiel tries to counter by going to the body. First thing for him, he has to duck that jab and then work inside. And that's the tough thing for the smaller fighter. He really has two jobs.
Exactly. He's not ducking him so far. He's leaning back. That can be disastrous. You see, he's almost setting up a lot of times with his stand-up style in a lean-back kind of situation. Selby is very rangy, big for a featherweight, quite obviously.
And make sure that Montiel is not comfortable at that point of attack with Selby if he instinctively he's heading back. Selby cutting off the distance here. It's a good body shot in. Selby very busy in the first round. So you always wonder what happens when a taller guy goes in against a fiery smaller guy. Well, in this case, the tall guy used his reach well.
Interesting first round. Montiel did get in a good counter right about a half a minute before the end of the round.
I think there are enough Montiels in that corner.
Well, it's a very famous boxing family, of course, in Los Mochis. They have their own gymnasium. A lot of great fighters in that area have come out of that area.
Father's the manager. And it's a family affair when you fight the Montiels. Second round action, Lee Selby and Fernando Montiel. Selby 21-1, 8 knockouts, and the IBF 126-pound champion. Fernando Montiel 54-4-2. Dave Bontempo and Rich Murata, glad you're with us on Premier Boxing Champions in Glendale, Arizona.
I always love these kind of crossroad fights, Dave, with the youngster meeting the aged veteran champion who still has something left, you know, and you have to climb over him. And a lot of times you see these great older fighters able to suck it up for one big last effort in a big, big fight.
All of a sudden they remember some things and bring it. And that's the intrigue that we get with this. You've got the history and you've got the now.
Montiel's trying to sow some movement himself, moving from side to side. That jab of Selby's is always out there, though, and he showed that in the fight with Gradovich. He just has it in your face constantly. It's wickedly quick.
And look what he can do off of that. You know, how he affects Montiel. Montiel can't get comfortable with that jab in his face. Here comes Montiel trying to slip.
And pushing the fight a little bit. The one thing that Montiel doesn't have to worry about as compared to when he fought Donaire is worry about a huge puncher in front of him. But Donaire, with all his ranginess, was also a big, huge puncher, which got Montiel out of there in a horrifyingly spectacular knockout in the second round. Selby doesn't possess that kind of punching power, so perhaps Montiel can take a few more chances in this fight.
You'd expect him to do that. Losses in his career, Mark P. Sharp Johnson, Nonito Donaire, Johnny Gonzalez, Victor Terrazas, all top-level fighters.
Tremendous lineup, yes.
And the wins over Juan Domingo Cordoba, Cristobal Cruz, Isidro Garcia. So, we said earlier, 11-4 against champions, that's a terrific percentage. Now, what about the style of what it'll have to do? We'll get into that more in the next round of what you're going to do if you're Montiel to get inside the reach. Which now I'll talk a little bit more about that in round three. As for now, coming to the end of round two, it slips into the night.
Nice little rally by Montiel to end the round. Fernando might have been able to steal the round right at the end there. Let's take a look at the action. There you see the what we're talking about, the ranginess of Selby. He moves a lot, but Montiel got more aggressive in this second round. Took a few more chances, as we alluded to. Kept coming forward and started walking through the punches of Selby.
Seemed to catch some confidence at the end.
Swelling in the right eyelid of Montiel.
Courtesy of a few jabs. Round three underway. Lee Selby, Pride of Wales, the IBF 126-pound champion, in his first defense against Fernando Montiel. Now, Rich, we talked about the reach advantage early for Selby. Now, for Montiel, who's used to having to get inside these guys, what is the first thing he has to do to slip that jab and go to work inside?
I thought the side-to-side movement was kind of working for him a little bit there, and some real lateral movement, and then an attack off of that movement, which was I thought was successful at the in the last minute or so of round number two. So I think he's feeling that he can take Selby's punches and is willing to kind of eat some of those jabs. But moving the side to side, I think, is better for him,
as opposed to moving straight back, which he had been doing in the beginning. Found a little bit of a rhythm. Such a timing synchronicity. You want to move inside. You want to duck a shot. You want to be in position.
There you see that side-to-side upper body movement. Montiel showing him now, and he's getting away from those jabs.
Take away the home for those jabs. He may get the guy to rethink what he wants to do. Good right hand by Selby. He rethought that. Liked his right hand.
It's really quick, isn't it, Dave? Man, when he lashes out with that right.
And that came from far away. It came from out of nowhere.
Selby has the ability, of course, to hide that right hand behind his off-the-thrown jab, but that time he just threw a right-hand lead, and it was so quick that Montiel could not get out of the way.
If you're fast enough, you can break a lot of the rules. You're never supposed to throw a right-hand lead against a righty, but if you go against the book and you're fast, well, you're okay.
And of course, what can happen?
Big shots.
He might
Montiel.
No knockdown.
Well, no knockdown, but he was in that realm.
His glove did touch the canvas. What happens, I think, a lot of times when you fight a fighter like Selby, is that you become kind of mesmerized, almost hypnotized by that left hand. He throws so many jabs, you're looking for it, and you're just waiting for the jab and jab to come. You forget about the right hand, and then you can lash out with that right hand lead.
Interesting to take another look later about those gloves of Montiel. If they touch before the referee signal, then that should have been a knockdown. Robert Byrd was right there. In the meantime, excellent round on the outside by Selby.
I agree, Dave. That he's really had a very dominant third round here.
He puts it away.
Now listen, Martinez is going to pull off this upset, and it would be a huge upset against the southpaw.
Take a look at that last round sequence.
But you know, actually the glove touched the canvas and then the punch came, so that's why it was not called a knockdown by Robert Byrd. There you see that good right hand thrown by Selby. He landed a few of them in that second round, showing the quickness with that right hand, and it is a stinger.
Stand to stand straight up. So act like you're going over here. Bang! Second thought. Right hand. You do that, that's the southpaw killer. And that's the ticket to a huge win. A big upset, baby.
That's a nobody arguing with Robert Byrd, so they agreed with what we saw about the gloves touching, but before, not involved in the punch. So here we are into round four. Lee Selby and Fernando Montiel. It's a good one. Set for 12.
You know, Montiel at the end of round two, in that last minute, Dave, picked up some confidence, some momentum. But Selby, I think, a great bounce back round immediately to put a halt to that and not let Montiel build up even more momentum in round three.
And it's something how certain fighters and a certain type of fighter instinctively know when they have to answer from that momentum standpoint. That's what Selby did throughout round three. Now Montiel is trying to answer, but Selby throwing the crisp right hands and getting there first.
Montiel did do a nice job of sliding to his left to get away from the jab and landing his own left hook.
Selby is trying to cut off the ring here on Montiel.
And Montiel is trying to utilize some tricks of his own and lure him into something. Make him miss. Now, there have been nights in Montiel's career, Dave, when I look back at, you know, during the last decade, that he just looked like he was an unbeatable force. He looked so poised and calm and skilled in the ring, and he made fools out of some of his opponents. He was so good.
And yet you get the sense that it'd be very tough for him to be able to do that tonight. Selby, very sharp guy, newly crowned champion, on top of his game, the boxing game on the outside.
that was unusual for Montiel. He just kind of lunged and rushed at Selby, which is more of an amateurish move than you'd expect from somebody with his experience.
Something else we haven't seen but we'll play into is, you know, Montiel coming forward. That sets up for an uppercut for Selby. Got the reach advantage of the guy lunging in on him.
Selby so wants to look good in this fight tonight and knows that he's got a formidable foe in front of him. He said as much. But he thinks that this can be his ticket to real stardom.
Good left hook by Selby, and then Montiel trying to close ground. Montiel saying he picked the wrong guy to make his debut against.
I think
the U.S.
He did say that. And I can understand why he would have a lot of confidence. Montiel is not jabbing his way in now. He's just trying to come in and hook. Take a look. He's not even jabbing his way in. He's coming forward and hooking.
And Selby doesn't scare him power-wise.
Very interesting round. Rounds of action, very brisk. There you see how Selby can be effective utilizing the distance, utilizing his jab. Montiel trying to figure out a way to get in. Montiel in the last minute of that round just didn't even bother with jabbing anymore, trying to jab with the long jabber in Selby.
Montiel, who had some good moments at the end of the last round, but has had trouble getting to Selby. And here is Selby, we're in the fifth. Dave Bontempo and Rich Marotta with you from Glendale, Arizona. Selby and Montiel. Will also have Devin Alexander and Aaron Martinez a little later.
One sign of a great fighter, of course, Dave, as you know, is the ability to adjust during the course of a fight if things aren't going well for you. And Montiel had a rough round and a half, and he changed his style in that last round. Here he comes in hooking again, just throwing three left hooks on the way in.
We're not believing in Selby's power, so he's going to have to try and challenge him as he sees it. Selby on the outside can pick him to death. But at some point, he has to figure out which is the best way inside.
And that doesn't necessarily mean fighting an inside fight, because I don't think Selby will ever let that happen. But what it means is to get inside of the jab to where he's within punching range.
And that's what we talk about with the shorter guy really having two jobs. The first job is to get somehow duck that jab. And then you have to be in punching position. And it's hard for the smaller guys to master both. Seen many a fighter get the first part and get inside, but then he's not in position.
Selby so far in this round keeping the distance right where he wants it, keeping Montiel in the end, the tail end of his punches.
Montiel risking more and more now, coming in, gloves at the side, willing to take some in order to throw some. Jab by Selby. Tried to pop in the sneaky right hand over the top after the jab got in. Good hooks. Montiel throwing caution to the wind, which is making some excitement. Even while he's getting outboxed, he's trying to gamble.
And I figure he just thinks he's going to have to throw caution to the wind that way. He knows he's going to be hit, and he's going to probably be hurt sometimes by those shots, but that's his shot. That's his chance.
He comes inside and is the shorter fighter, ironically, throwing the uppercut. Take a look at some of that action from the last round with Montiel.
And as you
gambling
see,
to get inside.
Yeah, and the rush right here, which he does, again, throwing two left hands on the way in. That seems to be his only way to be successful. He's at too much of a reach disadvantage to fight his normal fight. He's got to fight a fight that's not his normal fight here tonight, Dave.
And he's getting some mixed results with it. Round 6 of 12 underway. Lee Selby and Fernando Montiel. Selby trying to control this fight on the outside. Montiel trying to slip and then do his best work inside.
Selby's best work is just when he's busy. I mean, he's got to be busy in there. He's got to throw those jabs. And he's always going to be, when you talk about guys like Lomachenko, Leo Santa Cruz, these guys, and certainly Nicholas Walters. I mean, he's going to be at a severe power disadvantage against those
big
guys.
Big time with those guys.
So he's got to be a busy fighter and out-hustle everybody.
And here comes Montiel with a sampling of some success. A couple left hooks got in for him, and then there's a third that gets in. Three shots here by Selby as he sat down on his punches. To Montiel, you're trying to take Selby out of his comfort zone.
Look at Fernando, he's fearless.
Well, he's tasted a little bit of success here in this round as far as the punches he's been able to land. Selby is still effective outside, but we're seeing Montiel get to the punching spot easier than in other rounds.
And at times he'll just square right up to Selby, cut off the ring on him, try to cut off his escape pads. He knows all the tricks.
But Selby's showing a little bit of wear for the first time, and Montiel sensing that.
Montiel's rally in this round is getting the crowd involved.
But they don't want the sweet science of the boxer. They want some slugging, which is a fight that would be initiated by Montiel.
Well, the funny thing is normally when you go see a Montiel fight, you're going to see the sweet science out of him. But he's eschewing that tonight. He's going for the gusto.
He has to change gears, and it's a hard thing for him as he squares up. Selby doing well on the outside, but showing a little bit of vulnerability in this round.
They're all clapping over in Montiel's corner, and they're getting very encouraged. He has had a good round. I think he's winning this round.
So the smaller Montiel enjoys the sixth.
Listen, Right. You've got to use the ring. Relax there. Relax there.
Listen, go back to boxing smart now, right? Give him a clean shot and move away.
Yeah.
He'll make mistakes now. He'll be trying to check in with that big left hook.
Keep that right hand out on the way out.
Second time, let's go. Second time.
He'll make mistakes. He sensed a little concern in that corner, Dave. In the corner of Selby.
Well, so the guy being muscled a little bit. First time in four rounds they'd seen that, so. And he's starting to breathe heavily. So how will that carry over into the second half of the fight? We've got a storyline. Dave Fontempo and Rich Barada. Glad you're with us. We're boxing champions. Lee Selby, the newly crowned champion at 126, making his first defense. Fernando Montiel muscled him a little in the last round.
But this kind of fight, the aged veteran against the young up-and-comer, as old as boxing itself, and Montiel's asking him some questions here tonight.
Montiel getting inside without having to punch now. He's in position. And Selby is still getting to him when Montiel is coming forward, but Montiel is surging forward now with certainty that he wants to engage. Left up to the body by Montiel after Selby just missed going big with a left hook to the head.
Selby's going to have been in great shape because a lot of his attack is based on his own move, so he needs those wheels underneath him to be strong.
Now, when you're not a puncher, you never, in any case, want to jip yourself in the gym, but if you're not a puncher, you absolutely can't jip yourself in the gym. And he doesn't. He trains well, and he's come out to California and trained here for his last few fights. But even though he's boxing well in spots, Montiel is sensing a chance to load up.
I know there's a lot of eyes on this fight. I know many people on Twitter were talking about it today, and I think many of us were intrigued and have been intrigued by the potential of Selby because he was so impressive in that fight with Gradovic.
And this is a fight that he doesn't have those rabid fans behind him. He really would like to take the fans out of it since they're Montiel's. And the style dictates that he stay outside and jab.
That was good work there. He was able to finally land that right hand again. That one came behind a good jabbing attack. Montiel, it looks to me like Montiel feels like Selby can't hurt him.
Can't hurt him, but can he outscore him? That's what is going to be Selby's ticket, has been throughout his career.
Brisk action. Again, Selby got his jab to work. He was able to keep this round more at distance and not let Montiel be quite as effective as he had been in the round before. Good right hand and a follow-up left by Selby. Seemed to come back a little bit and have fight a more effective round than he did in the sixth.
Montiel squaring up there, and that's a cut out of the right eye of Selby that they have to concern themselves for the rest of this fight.
And Robert Byrd, the referee, is over in the corner with Selby right now and looking in on the goings-on over there as we look at the former champion.
Okay.
Montiel has been in this situation more often with his championships in three divisions.
Now the doctor is looking at that right eye.
This is when you need strong lobbying as you get a look at what led to some of that damage in the last round. It's a time when a vociferous corner man will earn his money for you. It's okay, Doc, we're fine.
Well, I'm impressed you use the word vociferous. I don't know if you can spell it, Dave. I know you know how to use it.
Hey, depends how much money I get to spell. Right by Selby. Here comes Montiel back. Selby with the stick. Use the jab. That's going to get three more off. See what happens when the Selby jab is working. Now Montiel gets into contemplation mode again.
Yeah. Gets mesmerized by that left. Good round so far for the kid from Barry.
Nice right hand by Selby, and then he keeps his balance. Squares up a little bit. Off balance, left hook gets in.
Selby seems to be getting his timing back in this round.
You go back to the basic.
Exactly.
Find the jab, you'll find everything else. Good combination by Selby, not a lot of pop, but was able to shift Montiel a little.
Montiel not rushing Selby as much as he was in round six and early in round seven, probably because Selby's keeping him on the end of those punches. Selby busier this round.
This is the second time that we've seen Montiel breathing heavily. We saw it earlier in the fight. We also saw Selby a couple rounds ago showing some stamina wear, but now looks like he's gotten a second wind. Selby continues to show the way, has a good eighth round.
I thought a very dominant eighth round.
This is what your champion.
Only one in the ring.
There's only one in the ring. Listen, lovely boxing. Nice long deep breaths. Put your lungs up. Listen, this is your area now. So my old man Milton, now he's a class four, wants me to struggle for him.
Then you see the cut in the eye is quite long and in a very vulnerable spot, but I thought the accuracy of Selby really picked up in that last round. His timing was much better, although he did get clubbed a couple of times, and that was a clubbing right hand, chopping right hand. But there you see the work that they need to do on that eye. It's in a dangerous spot right on that eyelid.
And then they can go right into the eye. So
it is a long cut. Boy, it's almost the length of the eyelid.
Will it be a blessing in disguise if it makes him stay outside and jab? He's got a liability to carry through these next four rounds. Selby and Montiel starting round nine. Selby has been getting off first. Would appear to have the edge through eight rounds.
I believe he's out. Dave, but I do believe Selby has the edge in the fight, but Montiel's been in the fight. Although that last round I thought was kind of Selby's most dominant round.
Two of the last three rounds he's put some good work together. And it will be interesting to see how he regards the problem with his eye going forward. You see him jabbing a lot. He has to protect that now.
Well, I've seen some fighters really get messed up mentally and get thrown off and change their style, etc., when they get a cut, if it's a bad bleeder. This one isn't a bad bleeder necessarily, but it is in a bad spot. But so far, it doesn't look to me like it's affecting the way that Selby is fighting at all.
Unless it makes him more protective in the sense of, okay, I'm going to jab, I'm going to jab, I'm going to stay out here and maintain a safe distance. After the concern we saw in his corner, we've seen him go out in the last couple of rounds and try to stay on the outside. Of course, fighters being fighters, and human nature takes over. You see an opening, you go in.
And there are times that I can remember a great champion, a Hall of Famer, Chiquita Gonzalez, the first time he suffered a bad cut. And he was another little man, another little champion in the flyweight division. He suffered his cut against Rolando Pasco, and it completely threw him off. He lost the ability almost to fight that night, that from that cut and all the blood, and he ended up losing his championship to a guy he was heavily favored over.
It's that wild card factor. When you get cut, or if you get shaken, or even dropped, how do you adapt? Selby is in control of the pace of this fight.
Yeah. And he's got the style. He's able to stop it, and it seems like he's able to blunt those bull rushes of Montiel. As he backs out, he's throwing a jab at the same and that's preventing Montiel from getting in there close enough to where he can get him with that hook. You might remember there were a couple of rounds there where he was landing that hook with real frequency.
Now he's landing the head. Robert Byrd acknowledges the complaint by Selby and what Montiel is trying to do. He's trying to use the head fake to get inside. That's serving as his jab as we come to the end of round nine.
From the previous round, Montiel rushing Selby, trying to make him pay up against the rope. Selby, for the most part, was able to keep the fight out at center ring.
Step on the side. Enjoy yourself. Enjoy it. Come on, you can do this. You're champion of the world, son.
Check it out. Let's go, guys.
I'd be a champion of the world. Why just go up and improve it?
Every time it stops working, you get back on it.
So a little bit of a pep talk in the corner. Not just strategy. That was more of a pep talk that he was getting in the corner, Selby.
Yeah, they want to guide their guy through the final three rounds. As he's had a nice effort as Lee Selby. 21-1, 8 knockouts. First defense of his IBF 126-pound championship. Fernando Montiel, 54-4-2 with 39 knockouts and titles in three divisions.
60 fights behind him. But for Montiel, this is probably the last roundup as far as a title shot is concerned. Dave, if he can't get it done here tonight.
Right, he comes in here. His name got him the fight. He was the number 10 contender in the division. What's going to separate you and what's going to get you into a spot if you're number 10, unless you have the pedigree, which he does from the previous titles. Selby has been able to prevent Montiel from having a sustained groove.
Right. And I think I'm sensing from Selby that he's coming out and setting down a little bit more in his punches in this round. Looking to punch a little harder in this round. And he might be dreaming of getting Fernando out of there.
Jabbing a right hand, well, that would be a coup. And also shows as he gets more aggressive, maybe less concern about that eye. Showed you the problems of that earlier. Hugh Montiel lands a shot right there. The job Montiel has trying to get in, he's got to slip, and then we've seen very few combinations.
And what was successful for him for two or three rounds, basically he's not been able to do again in the last couple of rounds.
Selby looks, where did I trip? Tripped right in the middle of the advertisement. Good left hook by Montiel. And right hand by Selby. Couple of good shots by Selby. He looks down again. He felt something might trip him up again.
He seemed more bothered by what's going on in ring center there with the canvas than he was by the cut.
Something made him uncomfortable with his footing. Well, take a look at that trip.
Montiel was coming forward, and you see that left foot kind of just go out from underneath Selby.
And he wasn't planted, and he went into a lunging type of a shot. It's a good shot there, though.
Yeah, nice. Beautiful sweeping left hook by Selby. But he ran into that left there. I thought he was trying to punch harder. You do that, you're going to take some chances against a guy like Montiel. There you see again the immediate work to the eyelid. That's different from a cut above the eyelid, you know, cut above on your forehead, which bleeds heavily down into your eye and can blind you. But the skin is so thin there on the eyelid.
You're worried about how deep it is at
exactly.
this point.
And what you don't want, you could have an eyelid actually hanging over the guy's eye, and that if it goes through.
This is when the cornermen have to perform. And here we are into the championship rounds, 11 and 12, Lee Selby and Fernando Montiel. Been a good one, and it's been Selby in control on the outside. The fact that they're coming up with a few Mexico chants kind of tells you how Selby has put this crowd at a distance throughout this fight. It's a Montiel crowd, but they have not had a tremendous amount to cheer for.
Yeah, you're not going to hear many of those Mexico chants in Cardiff, Wales, or in London.
No, but here's Selby over here in Montiel's backyard. Pretty much it's Los Angeles, but a lot of Mexican support, and he's from Los Mochis. If he'd been doing more, this crowd would have been behind him more. But Selby has kept them on the end of his jab too.
Selby's got a lot of energy in there. Very good legs, and they can keep him out of trouble in a lot of situations.
Well, the benefit of youth for him, apparent in this fight. Those younger legs use the ring more. Stay in your rhythm.
Fernando's getting low, squaring up again. Looks like he's going to try to come with that left again.
But now, as opposed to the first couple of rounds, it takes longer to get there. launched from a little further out. As a result, as you saw, just missed.
Most of Montiel's lunges now are resulting in missed punches.
These guys, a lot of fatigue on the end of those shots. And round 11 fades away.
Okay. 3 minutes away. 3 minutes away, going on with champion of the world, right? He's going to keep it together now. He's going to try everything.
Don't mess against my ball.
Just nothing like. Just nothing. Listen, he's going to try everything he can now. He's going to swing like that.
Last round coming. Touch up center ring.
Absolute brilliant basic.
Round 11 action. Montiel coming forward. You see, not quite being as quite as effective. A lot of these punches as he was moving forward and lunging and bull rushing Selby were missing. You may not understand what they're telling Montiel in the corner, but it's probably something along the lines of, this is it, old man. Now or never.
So Lee Selby and Fernando Montiel will meet in the middle, they'll tap it up, and we start the final round of this 126-pound championship fight. Dave Bontempo and Rich Barada, glad you're with us. Glendale, Arizona, Premier Boxing Champions. Devin Alexander, Aaron Martinez will follow.
Very excited myself to be here tonight. We've got current world champion, two former world champions, good up-and-coming prospect for this card. Got a little bit of everything.
We got one guy trying to parlay his recent riches. Another guy trying to use this form to come back into prominence. And this fight, Lee Selby has maintained his composure, and he's really used his height and reach well.
I agree, and it's important. He's got to do that, and he's going to have height and reach over most of the guys in this weight division. But without great power, he needs speed, he needs ranginess, he needs an outstanding jab, and he needs the high volume of punches.
There by Selby. Montiel wasn't sitting down on his punches, so there was nothing on the two that he launched. Selby in his corner have done a good job keeping that nasty cut over the eyelid in that area. Tamed it so it wouldn't affect him at the end of this fight. But he may have a bit of a layoff because of it.
And no matter what, and this may be the final minute that Fernando Montiel ever fights in a championship battle again in his career, he's accomplished so much in his career, Dave. A career that he really can take pride in.
You know it. Going back to 1996. Titles in those weight classes. And just ran into a guy here who stayed on his game, did Lee Selby. And maximized the height and reach.
Selby really dominated in this last minute. And would appear to be on the verge of a strong decision victory here tonight in his first title defense, although Montiel gave it a shot.
Gave everything in there. Selby kept his composure. And he kept the fight tactically where he wanted it.
I think the one thing that Montiel was unable to do was ever to really to get, and I think this is what you're alluding to get Selby to fall out of his fight.
Never
game,
could.
His style, his game.
Couldn't get him to slug when he didn't want him to slug. And number 26 here, this guy has been a title holder down at 15, you know, all of that. And tried to make one more charge, but.
To my friend who passed away on the weekend while I was out on training camp, Dopey Darren Bray. And my brother Max Levin up in heavy Massachusetts.
To someone close to him who had passed away recently.
Big difference though when you're a guy like Montiel who's 5'4", you know, you're fighting at 112 or 115, you can fit in there. You get up at 122, 126, trying to fit in at 5'4", Dave.
That's pronounced. This difference was pronounced.
But it was a briskly fought fight and a clean fought fight.
Good scrap. Selby has won 17 in a row. Looks like he's on the verge of number 18. Had a slew of continental titles and then finally got over the top with that win over Evgeny Granovich in his last fight. And then this being his first defense. It will be a little bit of a longer layoff for him than usual because of the cut.
Here are your score totals. Judge at ringside, Robert Hoyle sees the contest 119-109. Judge Chris Flores sees the bout 118-110. And Judge Jonathan Davis has the bout 116-112. All for your winner by unanimous decision. And still featherweight champion, Lee the Berry Boy Assassin Selby.
Well, the decision is correct. Perhaps the fans thought it should be closer than it was. I thought that Montiel won the second round and the sixth round, that he could have possibly gotten one more round in there, but I don't think he won any more than three rounds. And Selby was able to establish the style, able to establish the tempo, able to establish most of the time the distance that the fight was fought at. And he is a deserved winner here tonight.
Montiel, in the last three rounds, could not get to him, and so that widened the gap. But we were in that 116-112 camp, maybe a little bit more, somewhere between 16-12 and 18-10. Looked to be where this fight was. So Selby wins it decisively.